Okay, I would like to open the October 1st meeting of the Northampton License Commission. All the commissioners are present. We are both audio and video recording this meeting. At this time, I'd ask if there's any public comment on any issues here that may not come up later on the agenda. Seeing none, I will move on to a slight change in the agenda from the printed agenda that's up in front. We today received a written opinion from the city solicitor, just something about the process we're going to use for a later agenda item on awarding a available liquor license. We had decided to do a process of drawing from what we deem to be qualified applicants the name of a successful applicant for that license by means of a sort of lottery. And we decided to do that, but we never actually took a formal vote. So on the advice of the city solicitor, we will now take a vote. We had discussed this at our last three meetings, so it should not be a surprise to anybody, but we will now take a formal vote on this process. We are also advised by the city solicitor that there's nothing in state statute or in case law that would preclude us from doing this type of drawing process, so that I feel confident in proceeding this way. However, let me ask Commissioner Reel just to explain briefly something about the reasoning behind our decision to adopt this lottery.
As many of you know, the license commissions in Massachusetts have almost untrammeled authority, very broad discretion about what is the public good in awarding a liquor license such as this. One thing that a number of us were concerned about was the fact that there are a number of very fine businesses who would benefit from such a license. In fact, many of us have spoken publicly about the archaic system that has forced the creation of almost an artificial market in these licenses. So we talked about what's fair and transparent, what is going to help everybody understand. We're not here to tell you whether you're a good or bad business. What we're here to determine is whether a business is going to be promoting the public good with using this license. And so what we determined was that we would vet, in other words, we would ask people to come in and make a presentation, and we would determine whether any of the businesses who appeared before us seemed to be in our individual or collective determinations to not be qualified for the issuance of such license. Those businesses which are deemed not qualified will be put aside. Again, that'll be done by public determination and deliberation and a vote. And those who, in fact, meet the basic, what we believe to be public good for the issuance of such a license, will all be placed at equal risk in a lottery process. The mayor has kindly dug out of the archives of the city, as you will see to the right here, what has been used by the city clerk in other lottery type of situations. Cindy, if you want to show everybody the right now, every one of the applicants is written on one of these tags. Those will all be placed in there when we finish vetting and determining who is eligible and qualified to participate in this lottery. And then one of the lucky qualified applicants will be chosen. I think probably Cindy, as clerk to the commission, will be the most unbiased, and she said, well, I'm sitting right here, and we can vote on that also, but I think we're simply going to select someone from there and award the license tonight, hopefully get that license back in circulation as soon as possible. Anyway, I hope that's a brief overview of what our thought process was in arriving at this method of awarding a license. Brian, do you have anything on that?
No, that summed it up.
So, Elaine, would you make a motion to
I would move that we pursue the lottery process that has been discussed at the July, August, and September meetings, and that we pursue that process tonight.
Just a second.
Second.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Let me move on to one other thing. Thanks to a very helpful question from one of the reporters present, noted that we had an omission in our August meetings about this same topic. And I'd just like to need to amend the minutes. In our August meeting, we discussed this process again, and we also discussed the fact that I had gotten verbal confirmation from the city solicitor that this process was okay. We've now gotten written confirmation of that. But since this wasn't reflected in the August minutes, as pointed out to me by the reporter, I just want to ask my fellow commissioners if they recall their August meeting discussing, again, all of us were here, the fact that we're going to do a lottery, that we're all agreed on that. And also, at the time of that discussion, I recall saying that Attorney Seawald had said this was all right to proceed in this way. Commissioner Reel said that let's get something in writing, and I said I would ask him for that, which we just got today. So I recall that clearly as the discussion we had at the August meeting. And if the two of you also recall that, then I would amend, since I wasn't reflected in the minutes that were available, I would move to amend the minutes of our August meeting. Where is it again?
It's the last one.
A
discussion of the process for selection of the applicant for license number 09000043 took place. Chairman Rosen was to follow up with the city solicitor for more information. I would change this slightly. I think I do remember saying that I had received no objection from him to doing this. So what I would say, discussion took place, as we say here, and I'll say that Chairman Rosen reported that the city solicitor raised no objection to the process of a lottery.
And I think I, at that point, interjected, I would really like to see something in writing.
And Commissioner Reel says she would like to see this in writing. I then said that I would follow the city solicitor for that opinion. So that would correct the minutes, and again, I'd like to thank Mary for bringing this up. Okay, so that's my motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, we've cleared that up. Now let's move on to the rest of the agenda. And as you can see, those of you who have an agenda with you, we will have a return to the topic of the available liquor license at item 12. So, item number 5, MB Enterprises Incorporated, DBA Subway, a common victual application, owner Matthew Baca. Is Mr. Baca here?
The name is Steve Baca, and I represent MB Enterprises. We want to open that Subway franchise restaurant at 193 Main Street.
Okay. Which storefront is that? That's the old Main Street Cleaners, right?
It's the Main Street Cleaners.
Okay. And you're
scared
a franchise.
Me for a minute. I thought my suits that were in storage had somehow disappeared.
Pardon me?
I saw on Mass Live. Sorry. That's totally inappropriate. I said, what happened to Main Street Cleaners over the summer?
But they moved a couple storefronts over.
Well, you can have a grinder now.
Now I can have a grinder. Mm-hmm. Florence is coming to downtown Northampton.
Sounds good to me.
MB Enterprises, a franchise?
That's correct.
Subway? Okay. And you've gotten Board of Health approval?
It's in the works. It's in process. The storefront isn't completed yet. We were hoping to open this week. Now we're looking at a week from today or maybe 2 weeks from today. But of course, all that will be in order before we open.
Okay. I have no other questions. I'll make a motion then that we approve the common vic license for MB Enterprises as a Subway, contingent upon, of course, receiving that certificate of occupancy, Board of Health approval, the other city permits that can be set. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Best
of
luck.
Yeah.
Item number six, application for short-term wine and malt license, Silver Skin Design Incorporated. 1 King Street, this is for a function on November 30th. Hi, could you just identify yourself for the record?
Lori Motika, General Manager, Silver State Designs.
Okay, can you tell us something about this event that you planned?
Yes, it's our annual holiday sale event that we have every Thanksgiving weekend on the Sunday of Thanksgiving weekend. And we have Spoletto's, cater hors d'oeuvres, and we serve complimentary champagne to our shoppers, and we give proceeds to the United Way campaign.
All right, and I see you have all the insurance and server information here. Do we have the server information?
Yeah, we're waiting
for that. Okay. Your service will come from?
Spoletto.
Spoletto, okay.
I was under the impression you already gave it to you.
I sent you an email today.
I have no other questions. Yeah, there is a fee. It's a $61 fee. And since Silverscape is a for-profit entity, they will donate their any profits from the sale of wine and malt to the United Way. Any questions?
No, I just want to make a contingent on the service information being furnished to us.
No, she's waiting for Spoletto. So I'll take a motion on that.
I'll move to grant the application for a short-term wine and malt license to Silver State Design for this benefit, contingent on us receiving the service information that's required.
Second. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number seven, request for change of hours. Pride, 375 King Street. Manager of record, Larry Williams. Are you Larry Williams?
I am.
All right. Tell us what you would like to do.
We'd like to make a formal request to change our hours for sale of alcohol on Sundays to 10 a.m.
Okay.
For the law that goes into effect on the 23rd, I believe.
Right, correct.
So 26th would be the first.
Okay. Yeah, the new law allows municipalities to approve on a case-by-case basis requests for change of Sunday hours. So you have requested you be able to open at 10 a.m. beginning on this Sunday coming up. Oh, no, Sunday, October 26th.
Right, 26th. Yes.
Okay. And you would continue thereafter on Sundays.
Yes.
To open for the sale. And I note that you have a vote from your corporation approving this action. I have no other questions.
I have a question. Exactly where are you located? I'm sorry, I have to
it's
get to you.
375 King Street on the corner of King and Damon.
Okay. Thank you.
The busy corner.
The busy corner.
Okay. I'll make a motion then that under the provisions of the new state law that we approve the application of Pride Stores at 375 King Street to begin Sunday sales at 10 a.m. on October 26th.
Can I have a further discussion before we move to vote?
Sure. I'll make the motion, I'll have a second, then we'll discuss
okay.
it. Okay.
I just want a little bit more information. What time do you now start?
Noon. On Sundays, noon. 8 o'clock through the week. But
okay. Is And I'm just thinking of the traffic in the location. I just have some concerns.
I can make a personal observation in response to that, and then let you say what you will about it. But it's always busy up there. It's really busy right now. It's jammed at that corner. People come and nobody's necessarily stopping at Pride. Some are. People trying to get out of there have a hell of a time. Sunday morning is probably the least busy time there. Nobody is jamming up the intersection at that time that I've noticed. Any night at 3 or 4 a.m. But that Sunday, during daylight hours, Sunday morning is less crowded. It's nothing to do with Pride itself, although you have a Dunkin' Donuts and a gas station, you're an attractive nuisance, as they say. But I don't see any problem.
You don't think purchasing alcohol and consuming it perhaps right there? I don't know. I'm really admitting ignorance because it is such a congested corner there. Whether there's any causal connection at all, I don't know. I'm just raising the issue for us to look at because we are moving it back significantly from noon, which seems like a reasonable time to something that's fairly, pretty early in the morning on a Sunday. I'm a child of the Blue Laws Bill.
Nobody could consume it, of course, on his premises right. At all anyway. Mm-hmm. They would have to leave. They couldn't sit in the parking lot, of course. So that is on it. But it wouldn't occur to me as about additional traffic being a hazard. Yes, people buying liquor earlier on Sunday was an issue, and the Blue Laws certainly constrained that sort of stuff. Constrained it altogether on Sunday until some years ago, and now as we loosen all of those things, the legislature decided to make this additional change. So we are free, though, as a body, to deny earlier sales if we wish on Sunday.
Well, I guess I'd like to hear from the business owner what benefit you see it to your business at being able to sell beer and wine at 10.
No, it's just extra hours, extra sales. The traffic problem is the slowest day of the week for traffic, so of course the traffic's not botched up because of the Pride. I think it's just there, so the traffic gets there. We don't allow anybody to consume alcohol on the property at all. We won't even allow them to open up a 12-pack to break one out. So that's not an issue at all.
I'm not going to stand against the tide. I just would prefer it to stay at 12, but on the other hand, I can't really think of a good, rational reason to just deny this gentleman's reasonable request since the law has been changed.
Thank you.
Brian, any comments on this?
No.
Okay. All right, well, we have a motion and a second here, so the motion is to approve the Sunday sales beginning at 10. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Same thing, request for change of hours. LFNO Incorporated DBA Liquors 44 Northampton. Is there somebody here from Liquors 44? If you could just identify yourself for the record, please.
I'm Andrew Morrison. The owners of Liquors 44.
Okay. And I note that we also have a vote by the special meeting of the directors and stockholders of your corporation to approve this. And you wish to extend your hours on Sundays from. Instead of opening at 12, you wish to open at 10 and to stay open until 11 in the evening. Is that correct? Okay. Do we have any questions for Mr. Morrison?
No, I've been educated.
All the hard questions. The last thing.
The, all right, then the application is here. Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to grant the change of hours for the law.
Okay.
Liquors 44 and LFF, no, DBA, one.
I'll second. All those in favor? Aye.
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 Thank you.
Thanks. Dwayne, here's something from the Package Store Association. It's doesn't have the force of law, it's just an advisory, so I'm not going to ask you these things yet. Okay, item number 9, application for short-term wine and malt license, Academy of Music. We have two dates, November 21st and November 22nd.
A lot of dates.
And November 28th, 29th, and 30th?
Yes.
Is that correct, Allison?
And December 23rd.
And December 23rd. So the event on November 21st from 5:30 to 9:30, pre-show reception and concession sales, November 22nd, a fundraiser, 5 to 10:30, November 28th through 30th, 20th anniversary concerts for Signature Sounds.
It's 4 concerts over 3 days.
Okay. And on December 23rd, a country Christmas sing-along spectacular. So tell us a little bit about these events in
sure.
turn.
These should be all of the November and December events that we're seeking beer and wine licenses for. The 21st is the comedian and author John Hodgman doing his one-man show. That's an Academy event that we're presenting ourselves. The second one there, the Positive Place fundraiser, is the AIDS support group at Dick. That's an annual fundraiser they've started having with us, and they want to do either a pre or post show reception with wine and beer available, and then we'll probably also, since we have the license, do concession sales that night as well of beer and wine. The 28th through the 30th of November are Signature Sounds 20th anniversary concerts. It is a Friday night, Saturday night, and a Sunday afternoon and Sunday evening concerts. A lot of their artists, and that would be all concession sales. And then the 23rd is the second annual event with us as well that Signature Sounds is bringing in, and we had a liquor license for that show last year as well.
Okay. And the any proceeds from the sale of wine and malt would go toward the Academy?
There are, yep.
And you have requested a fee waiver for
yes.
all these events. Any questions?
I don't have any.
No.
Okay. I'll make a motion then to approve these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 dates for the Academy of Music.
Separately?
Fee waiver, huh?
Do you need to approve them separately?
I don't know. No. We've done it before. It's taken a while. So we are
approving. Calendar of events. Why don't we make yes. a motion to approve the calendar of events as submitted?
Oh, well phrased. Okay. Okay, I move to approve this calendar of events as submitted with a fee waiver for the Academy. Is there a second?
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Okay, item number 10. Application for a change of entertainment permit. One Bar and Grill, 1 Pearl Street, Northampton. Hi.
Hi.
Could you identify yourselves?
Matthew Gibbs, owner.
Okay, thanks. So tell us what you intend to do.
Well, in no shape, or form do we want to change our format by any means. We're a live music venue. However, it's come to our attention that if we chose to do any holiday parties or things like that that would require a DJ, we didn't want to be in any kind of infringement on our current license. So we're asking the commission to grant us a license to allow for private parties such as either fundraisers or holiday parties of that such, to allow us to have a DJ, whether it's, you know, any variety of music. We're not looking to, like I said, we are not looking to try to change our day-to-day format one bit. We are a live music venue, and I'll state that boldly.
So it would be private functions only?
Private functions only. And okay. Again, we didn't want to step on any toes. We wanted to make sure we got in front of you guys before realizing that even though it is a private function, we just wanted to make sure that we cross all our T's and dot all the I's to make sure that we can do something like that.
The restriction on the previous licensees
was for entertainment.
Invoked at the request of the NPD. Mm-hmm. Have you talked with them?
We have not, no. And again, this is our first step towards making sure that we do everything necessary to obtain this.
Okay. Let me open it up to questions with the commissioners, Brian.
My personal thought is what's happened in the past has nothing to do with what the rights of the people that own the license now or have the license. So to me, if we were going to let them grant DJ for private, I would allow them to do what they will with entertainment. I mean, unless there's a problem. I mean, that's why this board exists. So I'd say we just let them do DJ anytime they want. So what they wanted to do, you know.
I guess I would have a slightly different perspective than that. Is I would want to encourage the applicants to speak with the police department about this situation, because what we're basically being asked to do, and maybe I'm mishearing, I believe, is to modify the current license that is there to allow, even if it is for private functions, to allow it.
If I may interject, the problems that were with the former business, our former business problems, understandably, we have an immaculate record in our history, both in our last businesses and with what we do with how we run a business. The main issues that the former business had was with how they ran their operation, which is night and day from us. So I just like to throw that out there as well.
And I encourage, you know, the changes that you've done. I applaud them. What I'm just simply saying is you're coming before us and basically saying, you know, we have a restriction against DJs and we'd like you to lift that in some respect. And I'm just simply saying, before we do that, I mean, there are some interim things. I would like to see that these applicants have talked with the police department and make sure that...
What would we, I'm just asking, what questions should we ask them based on our current business model? That's just my inquiry is, when we ask them, what are we asking them?
What kind of problems that they had in the past, and what their advice would be to you to how to avoid future issues. That's all. Just a conversation. I'm asking for you to have a conversation, not to say that you know they're going to tell you how to run your business. That's not what I'm asking.
Okay.
For.
I'm just trying to get the correlation between the two.
His current business has. I mean, it's so 180 what was there. I mean, it's just about things. There's nothing like the other business.
Yeah, the restriction, I'll just dig up old history. Again, nothing to do.
No, I believe
you.
I'm just trying to understand.
There, over a number of years, the police department had come to us with violations against the previous licensee. They eventually, the chief and the officers said, most of the problems come up on DJ night. So they asked us to put a restriction on the entertainment license, restricting the ability of that licensee to have DJ. Only live bands were allowed under the, and when this licensee took over the venue, the entertainment license stayed as it was with that restriction that the police department had on them. What you're proposing, though, is...
And we didn't oppose that. Initially, either we
right.
have no
we
intention
That's
of,
what I understand.
Of changing
that was
our
your
format.
Expectation.
Yeah. I believe we also mentioned that if they felt like they ever wanted to change that
exactly
before us.
I was about to say, yes.
So my question is,
just to you, my manager, I'm sorry to interrupt, but license commission with what you did here, what does the police department have to do with it, other than their opinion of the problems they have?
Well, we do have this broad authority in cases like this too.
Because I mean, in 30
days. And my own opinion, my own feeling is that just to cover everything here, I would just encourage, talk to the chief, say, we're gonna do this, we're not having DJ night. We don't expect a return to that. We went in to change the entertainment license. Any thoughts from you, okay? We're not giving the chief necessarily a veto power over our decision.
Yes.
We don't have to follow his recommendation. But in this case, I would ask you to do that, and I'll just open that back up to you two in the case that
do you answer. Sorry. Do you have any private parties that you're planning in the next 30 days by the time the next meeting happens?
None on the books, no. First, second week in November, we actually have a tentative one scheduled. So, you know, other than that, we're looking for the holiday season, basically.
Mm-hmm. If they did have a possibility of something, I wouldn't want them to handle their business. If it was a private party, you could go ahead and say, yeah, until they get full, you know, the chief has full.
Well, I'm thinking along these lines, too. What if we said for this proposed, in other words, for the first couple of times, that, and I'm not sure we can do this, conditional, in other words, that just as we've just approved five events at the Academy, can we approve the upcoming event in November and see how it goes?
I just feel like, I mean, can I just be candid?
Yeah, sure.
I feel like we're punishing this person for something someone else has done, and I don't think it's fair. And if I was standing up there and I wanted that license, I would want every right that comes with that license to me until I prove differently. You know what I mean? Until there was a problem. And then, I mean, it's not like in 30 days we can't say, we demand your presence at this meeting, and then we have it if there's an issue.
Well,
you know what I mean? Because they have a
whole different business. I hear your point. It's a good one. I do think it's a good one. However, they did.
Remember, I'm pro business.
Well, I'm a small businesswoman, so
I know.
You guys
again,
remember that.
Again, if I may, without wasting everyone else's time here.
Yeah.
We're not looking to change our format. We're not looking to do
right.
these. I mean, we're looking at holiday parties, and I don't want to get in the same conversation that says what they did on Fridays and Saturday nights is what we're looking to do.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, I want a guy to come in and play Christmas music. You know, it's a different mentality.
Right.
If you look at our business model, it is a live business model. We're not looking to change that. We're looking to cover ourselves and say, hey, listen, if I got a guy coming in playing Dean Martin songs and he's spinning it on a DJ turnstile, are we going to be in a bad spot by doing that?
Right,
so.
You have applied for a rather limited thing, change
mm-hmm.
in your current entertainment license to
yes.
do a DJ for private parties.
Mm-hmm.
I can't see any problem. You are a new licensee. I can't see a problem. You've restricted it yourself, your application to us, for just private parties. There's not even a possibility, in my mind, of
yes.
the previous, you know, sort of problems cropping up here. I just ask that you...
No, by all means.
Just talk to the chief.
Mm-hmm.
Just talk to the chief. So he knows what you know what this is about, and I would, you know, I assume he'll have no problem. I can't speak for him, but I would say this is probably okay.
Are we looking to speak with him and then come back for next month?
Can we avoid them having to come make an extra
yes.
trip? I don't think
I was
that's
going
necessary.
I was going to say this is rather limited. Again, he has applied for change for private parties. And my feeling is that we should approve this change. Ask you to talk to the chief. If the chief has any concerns, he'll get back to us and we'll resume the discussion next month. But I don't think he will. Maybe he will. But if he doesn't, fine. If he does, we'll talk about it again. Does that seem to you?
So to be clear, then you're gonna make a motion that you're going ahead with this, you're gonna grant it.
Well, you can make a motion.
Well, okay.
Before we do that,
as long as it's conditional that there's an understanding,
yeah.
good faith understanding that they'll speak with the chief. The chief can communicate to the license commission if there's any concerns.
Right.
Is
that's
that okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I make a motion to grant the application for change of entertainment,
okay.
and that we will take the chief's concerns under advisement to be heard at a later date if they come up.
Very good. I will second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Okay. Item number 11, approval of 2014 renewal process contingent upon inspections outstanding taxes due. Cindy, what do we have? Do we have any changes in the process with the fire department and the building inspector?
Not as far as I know.
Okay. Do we have anybody who appears to be delinquent in their city taxes?
We have a couple.
Okay. And you are proposing no changes to our renewal process from previous years? Okay. Any questions?
I just want to know if any of these delinquencies are going past a year, or are we
I think they're just on this year's payment.
Do we have payment plans that have been arranged at this point in time? I'm just concerned.
Not with us. It's just I've just received little notices from the treasurer's office. I haven't started the process yet, so I'm not as familiar with it. But I will be soon.
I just know that in the past there has been time that has gone by. I think I would like us to be made aware if there's someone who is going out a long period of time, so we don't just run the meter for a long period of time. Someone's in trouble, we don't know about.
Right. That. When we actually approve the renewals later on, mm-hmm. November or December?
November.
December. Thank you. At our December meeting, we'll get a report of any tax delinquents then.
That's fine. That's all I want.
We can make a decision then. All we're approving now is just the process that we haven't used in the past. So since there are no changes, I'll make a motion to direct the clerk to proceed with the 2014 renewal process.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Item number 12, deliberation and selection of applicant for available seasonal all-alcohol restaurant license number, et cetera, 43. I won't repeat myself about the process here. Let us just move to a consideration of the applicants in turn. Let me open this up first to you if you want to take this in any particular order, if you would like to make any suggestions about this discussion right now. Please do so.
Well, I just want to make a couple of comments about my thought process to make it clear that from my perspective, in order to serve the public good, we want to have someone who has a demonstrable track record, someone who is fiscally secure, and that will serve as best as possible the needs of the public in Northampton. And I think when we talk about the standard that's applied statewide, it is public good, what the commission sees as a public good. And so, again, as far as anyone that one business I may feel is not qualified to make the final cut, again, it doesn't have anything to do with people's stated intents or desires or dreams. It has very much to do with business practicalities and track records. We want whoever takes this license that has been unused for many years, we want to make darn sure that this person is going to be able to utilize it and will not be forced through through fiscal concerns, whatever, to in any way, shape, or form, turn it into another pocket license as we've had in the past. So that's my biggest concern. Someone have a good business record, serve the public good, and be fiscally sound.
Okay. One thing occurred to me, Brian, I'll let you go on. We should, we said we would continue the public hearing, and before we close the public hearing, I'd like to hear from any additional members of the public, not the applicants, but any other members of the public who wish to speak to any particular application. So as we can do it one of two ways. We can either ask anybody to speak shortly about any particular one, or we can hear any particular concerns about a particular applicant at the time that we begin discussing each of them in turn. So I would go with the second way of dealing with this. But we do want to keep the public hearing open to receive further public comments. Brian, anything I wish to say about the process or your thinking on this in general?
Yeah, I mean, nothing about the process generally. You know, I wasn't here for the second round, and I did read the minutes on some of them, but I just want to make sure that, you know, to be eligible, everybody's got to be able to stuff and all paperwork and everything and fees paid and so on. And I assume everyone is, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, do you have any?
I do have concerns about at least two of the applicants, yes.
Okay. Well, we can do this, we can start. I have a list here, no particular order, and we can talk about each one in turn, and then we can ask for any public comments on that, and then we can vote on each one in turn, or we can go through all of them and then have a single vote at the end to exclude or not exclude any particular applicants. Anything that you prefer, then if hearing no preference, then what I would like to do is to start with each one, hear any public comments after our before our discussion, and then move to this, and then discuss them, and then at that point we can vote on whether we deem them a qualified applicant or not. Is that agreeable to you? All right, let me start again. I have a list here, no particular order. Ibiza Tapas, we received the application from Mr. Suarez. And are there any concerns that said applicant is not qualified according to the criteria we have set?
Uh-oh, I just want to note one thing that we had discussed at earlier meetings, and I don't know that we brought it up tonight, and that is our expectation that whoever is awarded this particular license will operate it for at least a year before there's any possible change in ownership.
Right. So in other words, it won't be allowed to go
to flip it.
We'll just flip it.
This is for public good. We want somebody who has the intention of using this for a long-term basis.
That's an important consideration, so I think we should take a vote on it. Do you want to put that in front of the motion?
I'll make a motion that when the license is the licensee is selected, that they will be contingent upon them operating under this license for at least a year period of time, and that the license commission will not approve any transfer short of that period of time. Is that in English? I'm not sure.
Yes. I followed it. Did you get that? Okay. All right, it's been moved and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
So, all right, anyone then that receives said license and is approved, of course, by the ADCC, shall be required to operate this for a minimum period of a year.
One quick question.
Yes.
So if there happens to be a build out in a certain way, does that start after you think of an opener from day one?
We said that we would give people a reasonable amount of time to do any build out, any renovations that they had to do. So I think we could be reasonable about it. I don't know if we have a definite, we can put a definite time, how long will it take, you know, to do the needed construction or anything like that.
Are you asking when the year starts?
Yes.
I think the year starts when we issue the license. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't think we can really, it would be a nightmare to try to administer.
No, I'm...
So, say...
I just want to clarify.
The license has to be approved by the ADCC, so should we say from that point, not when we approve, when the ADCC does? Then anybody would have a reasonable amount of time within that year-long period which to complete the renovations of the property and commence operation. And they would be precluded only from moving, selling the license a year from the date of ADCC approval, is that what we're saying?
Yes, I think that's good clarification.
Okay. All right, then. Okay. Again, let me proceed to each applicant in turn. Rias Bajas LLC, DBA Vita Tapas at 7th Strong Avenue. Before we begin any discussion of this applicant, is there any member of the public who has not previously spoken on this who wishes to speak to the application for an all-alcohol license by Vita Tapas? Seeing none, let us move to discussion then of this application. And again, the question before us is, is this applicant qualified according to the criteria we have set? And I'll begin the discussion, Brian.
Well, there's nothing holding them back, is there? I mean, they filled out their application, so that's an issue on that. They're a viable restaurant now, correct? And they also hold a wine and malt, is that?
Yes.
So I feel that they qualify.
I have to second Brian's observations. I think, from my point of view, I want to make sure that we have an operation that's fiscally sound. We have their financials, that they have an established track record, and they have demonstrated adherence to the public good. And they've certainly been operating with a beer and wine license and doing that in a commendable, acceptable fashion. I don't see any reason that they don't meet qualification as a business that would promote the public good.
Then, Cindy, do we have what we need? I noticed a couple of things not on the checklist here. Do we need these at this time, or wait for the ADCC?
It's waiting until the ADCC.
Okay. All right. Okay, then. I will entertain a motion then to say that Ibiza Tapas is a qualified applicant for purposes of this process.
I'll so move.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Let us move on to Sierra Grill. At this time, is there any member of the public who wants to comment on Sierra Grill's application for for an all-alcohol license. Okay, seeing none, I'll move to discussion. The same, as far as I'm concerned, the same considerations you two expressed in the previous applicant apply here. This is a well-established business with sound financials. They currently operate a wine and malt license and have had no problems. They have promised a number of innovative culinary or mixology features to their restaurant that that seem to be attractive, and I can see no reason not to consider them qualified. Brian?
They have a fantastic business model, and they've been doing great, so I would agree with that.
I concur. They're fiscally sound. They have a great track record, and as far as I can tell, we haven't had any problems with their operation. I think they're also qualified.
Okay. Then I will make a motion to consider Sierra Grill a qualified applicant for purposes of this process.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. The next one is Hinge, which is Healthy Karma LLC. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak to this application Hinge for an all-alcohol license who we've not previously heard before? Please come forward and identify yourself for the record.
Good afternoon. My name is Marvin Cable. I'm a local attorney here in Northampton. I've lived here for 7 years. My wife's a pediatrician at Northampton Area Pediatrics, and I have a 3-month-old daughter. I can't answer questions on behalf of the applicant, but I have worked with him. I know there were some issues in terms of noise in the past with the past ownership, but I know, similar to Tolly's and that issue with one, that that has been resolved. I think them getting a liquor license will increase the attractiveness for people to come to Northampton, because they are considering putting on local entertainment events, and as you know, Northampton is a center of entertainment, and granting them this license could help the area out a lot. I know Aaron has a lot of intentions too to make this a more arts-friendly area with some of the money, and I think it would be a great addition to the community. Again, I can't answer any questions because I don't formally represent them, but I do think this would be a great addition.
That was my
addition.
Question, whether you're here in a representation.
Right. So. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak to the application of Hinge? Okay, seeing none, let us move to deliberation on this.
Elaine,
why don't you start?
This is very difficult. I have. When I said before that I can respect and wish the very best for certain businesses that have dreams, goals, missions, etc., that doesn't mean that I don't feel in my heart of hearts that we need to be very hard-headed. We've had some past history with licensure issues, and we don't want to predict this. I think Hinge right now has, I believe, a seasonal...
No, they have an annual wine and malt license.
All right, they have an annual malt license, right, wine and malt license. And I think that is where they should stay right now. I think fiscally we've heard, there was, I don't know, Cindy, if you received any of the documents that were promised to us. I haven't seen anything show up.
I'm not receiving documents.
Because I was very concerned about their fiscal viability. The 51% current owner indicated that they had been close to bankruptcy several times, and that he was looking to transfer because fiscally this did not make it as a restaurant, and that Salvation was going to be to turn it into a nightclub. I don't think that's fiscally sound, or that is a viable track record that I can get behind. I think that in the future, future, this may well turn into a secure, fiscally sound. I would be very, very concerned to have us include them as a qualified applicant. As much as I appreciate the energy, drive, and I said dreams of this young entrepreneur, I give him, you know, all the best luck in the world. But I think I have a responsibility to look, as I said before, for the public good and what's going to best serve the needs of Northampton. Not based on wishes and hopes, but based on actual demonstrated track records of businesses. And so for that reason, I will oppose Hinges being included as a qualified applicant.
Right.
Well, I mean, I don't know much about what you're talking about as far as their past history. So, I mean, I did read all this. So the new, we're talking about the 51% holder right now that has had issues or been coming close to bankruptcy, is what I'm saying.
He reiterated several times that yes, there.
So now has the, you know, parents' business model, is it changing from Brian's? You know, because I don't know what they're about other than.
Well, we closely questioned about the fiscal. I mean, again, we want to see the fiscal stability. And, you know, was there a business plan? Was there some finance? And again, we were given a number of promises that certain documents would be given to us showing that there was going to be a business loan from a bank. They didn't have any.
Did it ever come out?
No.
Nothing?
No. Nothing has come forward. And we don't get these licenses very, and I don't want to, you know, set us all up to fail and have to go through this process.
So what happened, Aaron, what happened with that paperwork?
So I've talked to the bank and said I would not pledge the license. It was given to me. Nothing's really gone too much further than the last meeting. But I have funds to get things going personally, and I'm going to be taking full ownership soon enough, hopefully. And I'm not Brian, and I'm here. I actually live upstairs in the establishment, so I'm there from the moment it opens to the moment it closes. And, you know, we want to do renovations, and we are starting. We're at least going to do the double the size of the stage and the sound equipment and the sound paneling, but the place doesn't need too much change. And what I've seen in the time that I've been there is that there's certain aspects, and we're channeling money into things that we shouldn't be, and we should be more focused on the entertainment and the arts and the live music, because that's what keeps us afloat, and that's what I want to be aimed 100% towards.
That's a big draw to Northampton. That's
yeah, absolutely.
So what kind of live events are you?
I've already started booking for October. Just nationally touring acts. I got Start Making Sense, Viral Sound, Seed, and these are just big bands that are going to have a lot of draw, and
what's
a lot of people are going to be brought in.
What's the capacity for people in?
208 currently.
Yeah. And do you have any investors lined up?
I wasn't looking to get investors. I have the money for what needs to get done.
It says here that you're going to be taking ownership within, 4 months?
Yeah, so that is, I mean, I'll probably have the money saved up by then to actually buy him out personally. I would like to just get the small business loan and do it all at once, but I'm going to do it as I can.
So the small business loan was contingent upon pledging the
No, it was not contingent. It just hasn't been decided yet. Still in the works.
Decided by the bank.
Would you be able to get such a loan if you did offer a pledge?
I have equity and an investment property that I would be putting up instead of the license.
So you're averse to pledging the license in return for a loan?
I wouldn't want to pledge the license. and it seemed to be like a negative aspect to it last time I was here, so.
No, I recall saying, I made a point of saying that we do not view pledging license. We have applicants all the time who come in, and unlike this process, they've been transfer license. Another guy has sold the license to that person in return for getting bank financing. They pledge that license they're buying to the bank. And
right.
I made a point of saying at our last meeting that we don't look askance at that. That's fine.
Okay.
Just everything surrounding that. The mere fact of having pledged your license is not a bar.
Doesn't affect things too much.
To our approval, because we approve transfers of liquor licenses to people who have pledged it in return for financing.
Okay.
So that's perhaps you
not an issue. Okay.
Didn't understand at the time, but you don't have now a small business loan, but you do have the prospect of your own resources.
Yes.
Underwriting.
Yes.
The renovations and keeping the cash flow in the place while
yeah.
while you change somewhat the business model. You're a nightclub now with a wine and malt license.
Yeah,
you're going to be essentially a nightclub, sort of.
More
you're going to make it more of a nightclub.
More looking to be labeled as a performance venue.
A nightclub to me is like top 40 music. Yeah.
No, that's not
so
what I'm doing.
So, right,
none
so
of these bands.
That doesn't seem like a nightclub to me.
I'm not bringing in any generic music.
Okay,
I'm
using nightclub in the sense that Pearl Street is. Or
well, I just don't want people to get the wrong idea what see, because everybody has a feeling about what Northampton's about and so on. And, you know, nightclubs are probably not the thing, but the live performances that you would bring. I can see that because there's a lot of different tastes in music. So whether it's what you're offering or if it's on Pearl Street what they're offering or so on and so forth, it's good to have different venues or you know, a lot
sure.
of different people. So.
Sure.
No, a nightclub, I meant exactly that. Like at the Iron Horse at Pearl Street.
But you
already are a performance venue. You already have music coming in there.
We
correct?
Have, this says, up until mid-October, these aren't going to be events that I've personally planned starting October 16th. Those are all the events that I've planned. This has been me getting prepared and not wanting to throw a curveball at the current employees and management saying, so, you know, kind of letting them know what's going on and making the changes, getting the security in place that we absolutely need. And honestly, the performances that we're gonna bring to town, there's gonna be people coming from the outside areas to attend this. And they're not just gonna eat at Hinge. They're not just going to drink at Hinge. They're gonna go to all the other restaurants, all the other shops, and it's gonna be good for the entire town. On top of that, me creating a nonprofit to put the.
Yeah, I understand that. Yeah, you had covered that before. Sorry to interrupt, but the venue now
mm-hmm.
has live music.
Yes.
The venue now has a wine and malt license. The public comes for live music as well as on nights when there's no live music.
Mm-hmm.
They consume wine and malt beverages. That continues in any case with a slightly different twist that you are.
It's quite a different twist though. Because
but it is the public coming to see music,
yes.
which they do now at this venue.
But more nationally touring acts.
Oh, okay.
Much larger.
Again, we're not here to talk about you know, genres of music or anything
mm-hmm.
like that. What's good or bad in the acts you want to bring, but the essential fact of the licensed premises is that the public comes in, they can drink wine and malt beverages,
right.
and on some nights there is live music performed.
Yes,
that is continuing in an enhanced manner
yes.
once you realize your plan. Okay, sorry, Brian.
That's all right. So that all being said, it's in my opinion that. If you're working in
So in other words, are you the most fiscally sound, you know, business here tonight? Maybe not. Okay, my point being, although that matters some, I still believe that that's no reason, especially if you're working with a bank in process and you have some other, if you happen to be in this process and you were chosen, I would like to see, I would expect, you know, the financials, you know, and for us to look at within a reasonable amount of time, being 30 days or, you know, the next meeting, to make sure that that's viable option, that you would be a viable option. So, and also, I believe everybody deserves a fair chance, you know. So, you've already got an operating business. Whether you're close to bankruptcy or you're not, that's not for us to choose or decide or even weigh an opinion on that, as far as I'm concerned. That's you and your business and your model. So,
again, that was.
I understand that. And that's why I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt, in my opinion. So I believe, it's my opinion, you should be involved. So.
Thank you.
I share some of Commissioner Campidelli's feelings about this. You deserve a chance to succeed. I think it's great to have, you know, more music venues in the city, to have people doing what you're attempting to do. But let me refer to what Commissioner Reel said. We don't have these come up very often. And the unfortunate history of this license is that it was dormant for a long time. And I would like to make sure that there isn't anything that could keep it from being in continual operation. I also had some of those questions when you presented at the last meeting in my mind about the soundness of your business plan, about the financing that you have, the self-financing and all that. I'm not sure that, given the criteria we have set here, that you are ready to you know, to say that this business is going to prosper and thrive. So I have those questions in my mind, and I can't decide if your self-financing plan is adequate to the task, you know, that you have in front of you or not. And given the number of qualified applicants here, do we take a chance on the one where we don't have that assurance of financial soundness?
There's really not too much that needs to be financed there. These are all things that we are going to do to make the place better, but it's good right now. It just needs to be changed a little bit and headed in a different direction, and that's what I'm going to be doing.
So you're trying to take a business loan to expand upon your business and make it better, not that you need that just to stay afloat.
Right. I don't need to get any financing.
So you'll be able to buy out Mr. Assange's 51%?
Within the 4 months, yeah.
Without any financing? Any further comments?
I'm just going to reiterate. I want to prove the track record we've had from my perspective. And this sounds very harsh, I realize, and perhaps too hard-headed, but I want those folks who are qualified to be people with proven track records in this community and who will serve the public good. As much as I may personally find this particular applicant appealing as far as his dream, his vision, that I don't believe is my role on this board.
Okay. Thanks, Mr. Craig. All right, then, if there's no further comments on this applicant, should probably make the motion in the same form we made the other motions. to vote yea or nay whether this applicant is deemed qualified for the purposes of this process. So, I'll make a motion to that effect, that we find this applicant qualified for this purposes, for the purpose of having the motion on the table. Do I hear a second?
So your motion is that he is qualified?
Yes, and then we'll vote whether that motion is. I'm making the motion.
That he's qualified.
But I'm making the motion for purposes of having a motion on the table.
So
that we can vote on it.
I'll second it.
Okay. All right. All those in favor, say aye. Oh,
to be able to vote whether or not he's going to be in. I just want to make sure I.
We are again. If we deem him qualified to be in the pool that we have, he may not get the license anyway.
Correct.
Say aye. For nay votes. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? No. Okay. So we deem Hinge to be qualified to be in the pool as well. Okay. Two aye, one nay. All right. We now have the application from Sylvester's Restaurant. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak to Sylvester's application for an all-alcohol license? Seeing none, we will move to consideration of this. I'll start this one. The applicant has a definitely has a track record, already operates one all-alcohol license just down the street, wishes to have this one in order to expand the business at Sylvester's. We have the information about their leases and their financial information. Are we missing anything, Cindy? Okay, then I see nothing to prevent us from deeming Sylvester's a qualified applicant. Brian?
I agree.
I'll move that we find Sylvester's Restaurant to be a qualified applicant.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, then next one is Local Burger. Is there anyone who wishes to speak to the application of Local Burger for an all-alcohol license? Seeing none, Brian? Okay.
I think they're an established good business with an enviable track record. See, they would be a qualified candidate.
They have they have no service of alcohol now, which is different from all but one of our other applicants.
Don't they have another branch? They have experience with an alcohol license in New Hampshire, is that what I remember?
Yes, he does. So. That would be the only distinction between this applicant and the others. But having said that, I also see nothing to deem them not qualified. So I'll make a motion that they do in fact qualify for consideration.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
The next one is Traden's Bar and Grill. They propose to renovate the old diner on Strong Avenue and turn it into a seasonal all-alcohol restaurant. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak to the application of Tradens for this? Seeing none, Elaine, do you have anything you wish to say about this applicant?
Yes, again, I'm going to say I'm very, very supportive of people's dreams and hopes and desires. I want to see hard business plans. I want to see a track record. And again, Mr. Jenkins apparently plans to purchase the building, saying he shows his commitment to the city. This is, again, something that's my same concern that I had about Hinge. I don't want this license going into a situation where it may not get used and it may get held in the fashion that it's been held for far too long. I would oppose this. I don't feel that the business plan here is or the track record, frankly, in Northampton is there.
Brian, do you have any comments?
Oh, I got a lot to say.
Okay, go ahead.
I think Tradens is great. So I live in East Hampton. He actually has a good track record that I've seen firsthand. I frequent the restaurant that he had there at least three nights a week. Keeping the work schedule that my wife and I both do, we eat out a lot. So I do understand that he chose to close that on his own accord. Probably location and some other factors that came into it. So one thing that you mentioned, you planned on buying that building, showing your dedication to the city. So whether you were involved in this or not, are you going to be going for a wine and malt license to open anyway?
I definitely will.
Yeah. So then, I mean, with that kind of dedication to it, what I've seen and how it's run, I would say that he belongs in the running as well. I understand your point of view. It's not built yet. It's not so on and so forth. But as a businessman, I've seen him, do it. Generally, if you're going to have an establishment, it's going to be gone in the first 3 years or less, I would think. So he can stand the test of time. So that's my opinion.
I have a question for Mr. Jenkins. Tell me about the, again, sorry, I know you addressed this at your presentation, but tell me again, what's the status of the property and the diner building that sits on top of it right now?
Yeah.
I mean, as far as its ownership and its encumbrances,
well,
liens and such.
Yeah, well, right now, the owner of the property is here, and he has experience. He's going to renovate it and get it structurally sound, and he has experience renovating the property. He renovated Jake's, and right now, he's working with me.
And he will be the owner of the property,
yes.
And you will be the lessor?
We're working on it.
See.
He's going to help me with the financing of this property, but I will eventually take over the ownership of the property.
When you say eventually?
Hopefully like within 2 years.
And how do you propose to finance the purchase of the property?
I will be able to get a bank loan by then. I do have a strong record, and I survived 7 years in East Hampton, so that's says a lot about my resolve.
Let me ask, where do you guys stand in the process of renovations and so on right now?
Well, I think he can better answer that if you want to hear from him.
I mean, have building permits been filed?
No, nothing's been filed, because a lot of this is contingent on me getting a license. And if I don't get the license, then I'm going to apply for a beer and wine and maybe even a seasonal all alcohol license, and then I will go through the process of getting all the permits and all.
We can't give out any seasonal licenses.
Okay, well then
all
the beer and wine.
All alcohol licenses.
Okay, well then the beer and wine.
I mean, under the present quota system in Massachusetts, the reason we're all here in this room
right. For
this stuff today is because there's a quota, and we can't issue any new seasonal all alcohol licenses. Okay. Nor, after this one, can we issue any new all-alcohol licenses, unless state law gets changed.
Right. I'm aware of that.
So,
which we all hope will get changed
right.
soon.
So this all may be moot at some point. But that being said, we have the law as it is now, and your intention, very good question there, is to proceed to redo Kathy's Diner and open a restaurant and serve wine and beer, because we may say you're in the pool right now, but you don't.
Exactly. You know, and I'm still going to go forward.
You still are going to go forward.
Yes.
Under the financing conditions you have laid out to us.
Yes, and financing is not a problem.
Mm-hmm. So you feel confident that with a wine and malt license, you would also be able to proceed
Definitely.
To get loans from banks?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Jenkins. Okay, any other comments or consideration on this, this applicant?
I think I've made myself clear.
Okay. Then I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion that we put through with the lottery.
Okay, I'll second that. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Nay.
Okay, two ayes and one nay. Okay, then we have one more. Olive Juice Company Incorporated, DBA Bistro Le Gras. And this applicant has applied to operate all alcohol license at 25 West Street. Is there any member of the public who wishes to speak to this license application? Seeing none, move to deliberation on this. I'll start this one. We seem to have everything in order here. They have a current wine and malt license. They have submitted their financial forms that show that they've been in business here at this location for a number of years, and it's a difficult location, so it seems to me they must know what they're doing and have the backing to do it, so I would find them qualified under the criteria we have set. Brian?
I'm good. I think they qualify.
I think they've got a proven track record in fiscal.
Okay. They do have this difficult location, so. All right, then I will make a motion to consider Bistro Le Gras qualified applicant.
Second.
In this process. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right, that concludes our consideration of this. I will now make a motion to close the public hearing.
I'll second.
All those in favor, say aye.
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 Okay, all right, we have seven applicants, and by vote of the commission, all seven have been qualified. So now we'll move to the long-awaited lottery. So, this is new and different. Who was that woman who used to do the Massachusetts lines? Dawn?
Yeah.
Traden's Bar and Grill.
Woo-hoo.
Local Burger. Bistro Le Gras. The Sierra Grill. Sylvester's. Ibiza Tapas. And Hinge. Once this is drawn, keep going. We have to then make another motion to formally approve this license, to send it on to the ABCC. There's a couple of other technical motions that we need to make too, but we'll go through those at a time. So we will choose a name here, and then we'll move on to actually make a motion to approve it. So Cindy, you may choose the You do not want to choose.
I don't want to.
All right. Mary? You don't want to either. All right. Allison?
Nope.
You're not here for anybody, right?
Well, I mean, I was on the agenda earlier, but I have no stake in this.
Okay. This is Allison. Is it Kleina?
Kleina, yeah.
Kleina from the Academy of Music. She has no interest whatsoever in this process, but she is well known to us as a person of fine and upstanding character. So there you go. All right. You may read it.
Easter LeGras.
Thank you, Allison.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Allison.
Okay. All right, I expressed thanks to all the applicants for putting up with this process. It was unprecedented. We hope that at some point the quota may be lifted, at least that's not we, but my personal feeling, and that commerce be permitted to reign unfettered here. I think, shown by the interest of everybody here, there is sufficient business capacity for additional licenses in the city, and certainly there's public interest in it. And I wish we didn't have to do this and exclude some and approve others, but that's just the way it is. So again, my thanks to all of you who got involved in the process. Much appreciated. We'll move on now to consider Bistro LeGras application for seasonal all alcohol license. Are they here?
I am.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, just so you're there so that we can go through this here. Wait a minute, where did I get you? Sylvester. Here. All right. We need a 16C finding. Bistro LeGras is located within 500 feet of Smith College, an educational institution. And under 16C, we need to make a determination that this will not have an adverse impact on the educational or spiritual functions of any nearby school or church. And we received the return receipts from the abutters. Have we received any objections to Bistro LeGras along these lines? Now I'll entertain a 16C motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Then we have the Form 43. Should we all sign it in this case? If this is a license, okay. After our process is concluded, we have an applicant that we have deemed not only qualified but lucky, and that we have to make a motion that they be awarded seasonal alcohol liquor license number 09000043. I will entertain a motion.
Make a motion that we grant it. Seasonal alcohol licenses for this lottery process to Bistro LeGras.
Okay, and we have a certain number of contingencies on this license as well.
And this issuance of this license is contingent upon the recipient maintaining and continuous operation this license for a 1-year period of time.
And we have a contingency, if I may add to your motion, that you convert the seasonal license to an annual license under the terms of the special act governing seasonal alcohol licenses in Northampton, that you pay the corresponding fee to the city, and that you do this at our next meeting unless you have, you know, a reasonable reason for delay to a subsequent meeting.
I'd do it now if you'd let me.
You can. Okay. So, contingent upon operating at this on these premises for a year from the date that the ABCC approves your license, and that you also convert as soon as possible to seasonal and pay a corresponding fee.
I'll second that.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
I'll buy a lottery ticket tonight.
All right, here's the Form 43. Let us all sign it.
What should I do now? Do I just wait for the, do you guys
talk
to send it to ABC?
Do you want to call me? I'll give you my phone number. You can call me tomorrow.
Sure. So I just want to make sure that the ABCC.
Yeah.
And I said,
sure.
Okay.
Well, you're luckier now than
you.
Thank God you didn't win that scratch ticket.
I know.
$2.
Actually, Smith College is lucky now.
They are lucky. Yeah. Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Okay. Our two former clerks are here. What is going on? Is there some significance to this?
This is historic. We wanted to see it.
I think we were giving out a Nobel Prize, right,
Fred? They do this with moose hunting licenses.
That was a Nobel
up
Prize.
In Maine all the time.
Really?
Yes.
So much interest
your
in this.
Up there.
We had not one but two reporters from the Republican here.
It was a slow day.
All right.
Are we
okay,
finished?
So I think we're done. Hold on. We need to approve the minutes for September 22nd and 23rd. These are the things where we considered all these licenses. Do I hear a motion to approve? I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any new business? Any new business? None? Okay, I'll move we adjourn.
I'll second that.
All in favor? Aye. Aye.